stressful, especially when we some areas were closing in on deadlines for some 25-page paper or some group project or some major exam. However, the after-hours discussions with friends, exploring some aspect or other of our faith, those were great conversations. We really enjoyed that. In one of those discussions in the library, my philosophical friend Antonio made one of those observations that forced me to pause and to consider. He observed that as we discussed all of our looming exams and papers, knowing that we are beings destined for eternal life, really puts our daily worries into perspective. That was true. Paul puts our worries and our fears and our suffering into perspective for us today, just like Antonio did. There was a lot of trouble in Rome for Christians of both Jewish and Gentile backgrounds. There was plenty of reasons for fear and some terrible temptations that had to be overcome. Paul warned his readers not to succumb to living according to the temptations of their physical and emotional appetites, which would kill them. All Jewish people had, not all that long ago, been expelled from Rome under Emperor Nero. They had recently been allowed to return and discovered that they had lost their property and their community ties. Jewish Christians discovered they'd lost their standing in the now Gentile Christian-run home churches as well. This created a lot of tension between Jewish and Gentile Christians, along with some rather un-Christian boasting among the Gentile Christians, now since they had not had to suffer this indignity, and they considered themselves morally superior. All around them, the Roman aristocracy was loudly expressing anti-Jewish bigotry that was slowly infiltrating into the tense and struggling Christian community. With an anti-Jewish pogrom having occurred in Alexandria and tax riots turning deadly in the nearby town of Patuli, I apologize if I spoke that incorrectly about it. Tensions were high and fear was flowing freely. It would have been too tempting to try to conceal or to drop the Christian faith and just blend into the dominant culture, hoping to stay safe in the shadows when violence and fear lurked around every corner. Turning from God, denying Jesus, and rejecting the Holy Spirit to instead live by their own strengths and guile might have appeared attractive to some, especially those who were either very fearful of the violence in Rome or those who were very new and inexperienced in their faith. How was Paul to stem this particularly dangerous tide, turning fear into courage? The world today is filled with temptations and fears as well. We are living in what has been called a tear-down culture. Instead of Roman aristocracy infecting society with bigotry, today we have all sorts of opinion makers, these two are not among them, who feel free, empowered, and often are well paid to spread one form of rank bigotry or another every day. This poison is eating away at the very fabric of our society. Violence and riots are the result. As a society, a great many folks seem to be ready to tear each other down, especially the folks that seem to be making a positive difference. Take a look at tweets and social media comments if you feel I exaggerate, or listen to the opinion shows. I had to swear off reading the comments that would be found as they were simply too vile and my blood pressure was raising too high. In this atmosphere of attacks, fear rises. Children are hurt by cyberbullies every day. Anger and angry attacks move back and forth between various positions in different faith communities and their atheist counterparts. And they have intimidated many well-meaning Christians from spreading the good news, reducing them to a fearful silence. Every day our culture presents us with an endless litany of ways in which we are deficient. To remedy this lamentable state of being, various companies provide us with all sorts of material solutions that are guaranteed to ease our pain, make our lives better, and help us to find the happiness we seek. Some of those solutions are designed to be abused, or to be very addictive. More often than not, the promises are not fulfilled, and we are left seeking solace elsewhere. Paul calls us to take a different approach. Paul writes to his brothers and sisters in Rome, assuring them that to succumb to the temptations of Roman life would be a quick way to die. However, turning to the Holy Spirit, bringing those most human temptations and appetites under control, then life will be yours. We are debtors to the Spirit. We owe our eternal lives to God's saving action for us through Jesus Christ. Now Paul makes a very powerful statement. To be led by the Spirit of God is to be a child of God. We are God's children. As God's children, we are not enslaved by our body's desires or by our fears. The Christians in Rome were not to be slaves to the pagan world around them. They were liberated by God from that world and the fears of its hostilities. Just as God had liberated the people of Israel from slavery to Egypt, so these Christian children of God were liberated, and when Israel was faithful, they remained free, just as these children of God would be free. Paul pushed on. Not only were Christians free from slavery to the temptations of the body and of the pagan world, they were also adopted children of God. To be an adopted child of God, a member of God's great family, in Paul's world, included benefits of both security and liberty within the family. Paul assured these struggling Roman Christians that as adopted children, they were close enough to God and God's loving embrace to cry out, "Abba, Father." Abba was Aramaic for Papa or Daddy, a term of endearment carrying great intimacy and affectionate respect. While this was often a child's first word, unless Mama got to that child first, it was also a term used by adults for their fathers or students for their teachers. Crying out in his language of childhood spoke to the simple need, profound love and trust that is expressed to our God, and it also expresses our deep need for God's love, acknowledging that we need this love and our help from God. Paul's final extraordinary claim was that as God's children, his readers were God's heirs and joint heirs to Jesus, the Son of God. This was amazing, liberating, and empowering. It remains so for us. However, Paul tempered this uplifting message with the sobering reminder that to be heirs to Christ was to suffer with Christ. The Christian pattern of suffering followed Jesus' and affirmed that people who followed him were united with him. That suffering also helped raise the early Christians' level of compassion for others who suffered in their world. The Holy Spirit comforted them in their trials, reminded them that they were the much-loved children of God, and advocated for them with God when needed. In verse 18, Paul said something very similar to what my friend Antonio said. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. Such is our loving relationship with God, our Abba. Those who stood to inherit tended to feel protective of the inheritance, liberated as these Christians in Rome were by being children of God, heirs to Christ. They were to work in joyful service of God and humanity, leaving behind society's dangerous vices and bigotry in favor of God's better ways. We are also heirs to Christ, to our Abba, our Father, and we are just as free. Let's take a good look at what Paul's extraordinary statements mean for us today. We are God's children, adopted by our loving God, our Papa, our Daddy, and made by God's loving grace alone, co-heirs, equal inheritors of Jesus Christ. This makes a huge difference in how we see ourselves. Paul invites us not to live lives of fear, shackled as trembling slaves to the edicts, whims, and bigotry of the society around us. We do not have to be scared or humiliated by how we imagine others perceive us, about our status, or about our standing with God. Paul calls us to cast aside such fear, saying, we did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, and to throw out the bad habits and numbing behaviors that have shielded us from those poisonous and paralyzing fears when they have inflicted us. Instead, we are to imagine and practice living a life of courage, the courage of all who know and truly believe in their hearts, minds, and souls that they are indeed the adopted children of the Almighty God, citizens of the holy kingdom of God, and inheritors with Christ to God's blessings and God's love. Then, freed of our own guilty, haunting pasts, just as in ancient society adoption freed the adopted child from past debts, we can toss aside rummaging through the past with regret and instead focus on our present and our future, in which we work to restore community and to maintain God's creation as good inheritors of blood. We need to ask ourselves how we live with this wonderful knowledge, and what difference does that make in our own personal lives? What difference does it make to know that we are unconditionally loved and of value beyond counting in God's eyes? No matter where we go, God is there, and God's love remains true. What decisions do we make this week that are made free from fear, free from slavery, and in the certain knowledge that we are loved by the Almighty, that the Holy Spirit has our backs, and Jesus Christ shows us the way to the future? Yes, we will make mistakes, and we will pay for them. Yes, we will suffer as Jesus suffered, and become more compassionate for it. This comes as no surprise. Yet through it all, we know full well that by God's grace we are loved. This is freedom for us all. Let's look at a couple examples. Author Jill DeHaan spoke movingly about why her family attends church regularly. She boldly admits, in a way only one liberated from fear, and that her family has a lot of secrets when they fill the pews. They all need God's love far more than they let on. They arrive at church wounded with pains that Sunday morning alone will not fix. They pretend this is not so. They are looking for God's love as expressed through Jesus. When she calls a proper Savior for improper people, she closes her article with a moving image of her grandmother from childhood. Jill writes, "As a child, I was puzzled that my grandmother couldn't wait to get to church, only to arrive and cry through half the hymns. I get it now. She had buried 3 young children and 1 husband, and she could still get to her feet at the wave of the music minister's hand, all because of Jesus. All because of the free, liberating power of our Abba's love, as best expressed to us by Jesus and for us all. In our freedom from fear, strong in the knowledge that we are loved, we not only live, but we can freely work in God's joyful service by loving others as we are loved. As the story of Joseph Kim's escape from North Korea proves, small expressions of love can mean a lot. Before the famine of 1995 swept through North Korea, Joseph had a mother and a father who loved him, an older sister that doted on him, and friends with whom he played catching dragonflies and watching cartoons together. With the great famine, familiar life crumbled all around him. As a 12-year-old, Joseph watched his father starve to death. The family lost their home. His mother fled with his sister to China to find food and money, and when she returned, Joseph's sister had been sold into bride slavery, which is a common fate for young North Korean refugees in China. Joseph's mother continued to secretly travel to China for help until she was caught by the North Korean government and imprisoned. Alone, Joseph became a street beggar. At 15, he decided to flee North Korea in the hopes of avoiding starvation himself. In China, he had no idea where to turn for help. He'd assumed that people would be willing to just hand over leftover rice to him, and he was wrong. In time, though, he was guided to Christian churches. Confused by the suggestion that he find a Christian church, having never met a Christian or seen such a structure, it was described to him as a house with a cross on the top. You see there? On one church, he found the words, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." He felt that these words spoke to him directly. At the church, he met a neatly dressed woman who greeted him with a smile. This surprised him, as he was in a very disheveled state. He hadn't had a shower in weeks. When he asked for money, he made up a story about a sick sister in another town to add urgency to his plea. And she gave him the equivalent of $8, 50 won, and wished him well. It was more money than he had ever seen. When he came back days later, hoping for more cash, several church members who met him suggested he stay in the church for a time. Since he'd been living through the winter in an abandoned house, he thought this sounded wonderful. He took them up on their offer. After a week, however, he met once again the neatly dressed woman who had given him the cash, and his story, the lie that he had told, became clear. She did not scold him or cast him out, as he feared and expected. One afternoon, Joseph overheard the congregation discussing the fact that the pastor needed dental work and didn't have the funds to get it done. And at that point, Joseph realized this woman had given him money she simply couldn't afford. Her generosity made him curious Christian, Korean, Chinese woman living in another town because churches could not shelter North Korean refugees legally. There he learned about her faith. The Bible passages began to take on meaning, and he learned to pray. In time, he was introduced to a South Korean missionary who sent him on to the United States and to a new life. By the time Joseph Kim had fled North Korea, he had lost all faith in humanity. Finding caring, loving, liberated Christians, he learned to hope again and discovered God's love for him. There's an old parable about an eagle raised among chickens. She learned to live as chickens live, scratching in the dirt for food and remaining forever earthbound. From time to time, this eagle would raise her eyes to the heavens and marvel at glorious birds flying overhead. They were other eagles. Paul tells us in today's message that we are eagles. Understanding and believing that we are loved by God, co-inheritors with Christ of God's kingdom, Paul calls us all to take free and joyful flight. Let's pause for a moment of silence.